Now they're going for $2.788 billion for this one. It's like everyone's freaking out. It's like, oh, what? They're not allowed to dethrone a movie that cheated just as much or more? I mean, Avengers is still in theaters. If they want to extend it to get that number, they absolutely should. They absolutely should.
What's up, guys, and welcome to Beside the Point here on Nerdy Blurb TV, and we got an awesome episode for you because we are about to see some history coming up soon. Avengers Endgame is going to be hitting that crazy record of beating Avatar at $2.8 billion, and they're going to be having an extended release. Let's talk about it. Is it necessary? Is it something that's going to actually happen when it comes to breaking the record? Let's find out. Presented by None of This Really Matters, this is Beside the Point here on Nerdy Blurb TV. I'm Ryan, and I'm joined with an awesome YouTuber who has crazy, crazy awesome content. I would even say legendary content. It is the stuff of legend. Thank you so much for it. And he's repping the merch, everybody. Take a look at that friggin' awesome shirt. I don't know who designed that, but I think it's pretty dope myself. Daniel, how you doing, man?
I'm doing great, man. Thanks for having me. I'm really excited. This is probably my favorite t-shirt. also, don't know who designed it, but you know what? It's a blessing, and I think it matches your hat. Which I also like that hat. That's a nice hat.
Well, that is all thanks to a viewer and a friend of ours, Comment Man Jake. Go check him out, but definitely go check out the stuff of legend. He makes crazy awesome nerdy content. He does a lot of fan casting as well, which in my personal opinion, he owns the market when it comes to YouTube fan casting. Go and check out his stuff because it is, again, legendary. But today we're going to be talking about not only a legend in itself, Avengers Endgame, but the fact that it's probably going to be within the next 24 hours, Avatar, which is a crazy feat. We're talking $2.8 billion. It's never been done before. This is a record that like shattered the glass ceiling for years now. I mean, nobody's ever gotten close. Just let's talk about it, but let's talk about how we think it's going to get there. A lot of people are talking about this extended release that Kevin Feige, the MCU, is coming out with. Daniel, what do you think? First off, do you think it's going to happen? Do you think Avengers is going to hit that mark?
Look, man, here's what I think. It's so dang close. It's actually less than 2.8. It's just shy. It's like 2.788 billion dollars where Avatar's at. And as of like so many hours ago, I forget how many hours it is, but Variety did an article that basically says it's less than $44 million away from the record. And to put this into perspective, like what the whole topic we're talking about today is that Avatar was unbelievable. The amount of dollars that it created as a movie is unparalleled. It has been up till now, up till Avengers Endgame. Avengers Endgame's, I think, 10 weeks run right now in the theaters, or like 9 or 10. It's not that long. Most films are usually like something like 15, and they fizzle out. Some are less if they're smaller films. If they're big blockbusters, they usually run between 10 and 15. That's usually kind of where it is. Endgame, of course, is arguably the biggest movie of all time next to Avatar, but perhaps even bigger as far as pop culture is concerned and the impact that it has there. But it's accomplished all of its success, it's still in the $2.7 billion range, but it did it in 9 weeks, right? So as opposed to Avatar, which a lot of people are not aware was in theaters for 66 weeks. To put that into perspective, a year is 52 weeks. It was in theaters for 66. How did this happen? they had to, it was at a time when the 3D was, it was one of the most garbage ways to watch a movie, but they had just come out with the gray goggles, you know, like the new, like it's not red and blue, it's the gray one. And it's less harsh on your eyes to watch a 3D movie. And they came out with, like, they utilized, James Cameron utilized some of the best technology we've ever seen for 3D, ever. Some of the most seamless, the best, great CGI, a good story, which is almost identical to Pocahontas. I'm not hating. I actually do enjoy the film, but it's undeniable. It's very
No, it really is. I mean, everybody looks at that and says, that's Fern Gully meets Dances with Wolves. Of course it is.
Yes.
It's a story that's been told many times. James Cameron is very much in love with the world, and he's a tree hugger himself. Not that there's anything
right,
wrong with
like,
that. There's a story there. So yeah, it's pretty crazy that the technology that he made for it, because that's the whole reason, that was the biggest push to get people into the theater. But the crazy thing is that yeah. they did it within the amount of time that you had said, 66 weeks opposed to Avengers 10 weeks. And the big thing today, and mainly the big thing that we're going to be talking about, is the extended release, not a re-release, right. as we were talking about earlier, but an extended release, kind of like the extended version of Avatar, but that never came to theaters. It came out on DVD. We're going to be seeing
right.
new deleted scenes, new end credit scenes, and all of that. Some people, as we were talking about beforehand, before we started recording, some people may be arguing about the fact that that's cheating, or they shouldn't undercut Avatar like that, or they're not going to be winning it. I think by what you're saying, like having it be in for 66 weeks, Avatar, they had all the time they needed, and Avatar, like with Endgame, it's just like, I mean, now they're actually starting to play their cards, you know? I mean, what are your thoughts on that? Is it really cheating, or do you think they could have done it? Do you think they could have done it within 66 weeks, actually?
Here's what I think. Honestly, at the rate that Avengers has gone and is going, and of course, it's trickled down considerably, as all movies do, including Avatar. Avatar had legs, it kept going, but it was going at a slow pace. They kept it going for 66 weeks to make $44 million more. That's not a lot, $44 million more
yeah.
than what Avengers did in 10 weeks. So the trickle was drastically slower, and then it ended. And then they actually did a official re-release of the film in theaters worldwide. And then they hyped it up saying, this is the buzz that it got. This is what the critics are saying. This is what the fans are saying. We have all these reviews. You probably missed it. So we're going to re-release it for you guys. And if you didn't check out the Ultimate Experience in 3D, which kicks the butt of Spy Kids 3D and Sharkboy and Lava Girl, it's going to be the greatest, hottest thing ever. Take your kids, take your family. It's a great message about the earth and saving the earth and all that stuff. And so it became more than what it was as a movie, and they dragged it out for the rest of the year, you know, and like for an additional year, basically.
Right.
So at that point, I think even if they didn't do this re-release, quote unquote, with Avengers, because it's not a re-release, it's an extended release.
Right.
But the quote unquote re-release is almost unnecessary, because I do believe that as it goes, even with the decline in viewership, if Avengers stays in theaters for, I would guess, 5 more weeks, it would do it without the deleted scene.
I was going to say this about the same amount of time, 5 to 6 weeks, it could probably clench it, which
yeah.
I think at this point, a lot of people are thinking that maybe Avengers should be out of theaters conventionally, not because people are sick of it, but because like this is around the same amount of time when normal movies leave the theaters. I mean,
right.
any other MCU movie has left the theater by this amount of time. Any other like Crazy Rich Asians or Us or whatever, that they didn't go this long, so they have already gone over a conventional limit. I can get that, but do I think that it's cheating? No, I don't. I think this is Kevin Feige at his finest. This is producing at its finest. This is how you
at its finest.
This is how you make money. This is what you do. This is the game. But the thing is that whether it's cheating or not, I really honestly believe that people are going to go and see that because, first off, it was a great film. Second off, yeah. And beside the point on all of that kind of stuff, Avatar was a great film. I own it. I've watched it several times. I enjoy the movie. Is it better than Avengers Endgame? No, I don't think so. I don't at all.
It absolutely isn't.
Avengers Endgame is a great movie. People want to go and see the movie. There are some people that I know have not seen the movie, but they want to. Like there's always so many movies that come out and it's like, everybody, like, you need to see it. It's like, oh, I can sit this one out or watch on Netflix. Everyone I know, even people, the very rare people that I know have not seen it yet, want to see it or a part, like, even me who's seen it once, want to see it again, more than once.
Hey guys, my name is Trevor, and this weekend, Avengers Endgame re-releases, and I think it's a little bit earlier than all of us expected, but it's trying to do the impossible and dethrone Avatar as the number one box office leader, and Avatar's sitting comfortably. They're currently sitting at $2,787,965,087. That's a big number. That's more than I can count on these here fingers. But Endgame is about 30 million behind it. It's almost there. It's re-releasing a little bit earlier than all of us, I think, expected it to. But it's trying to do it. It said, hey, we got some bonus footage. We got a couple post-credit scenes. And we are trying to go all in to beat Avatar. Endgame had so much emotion, so much impact on everyone's lives. And Avatar did it. To me, it's one of the most mediocre films ever. I get it. James Cameron, the visuals, man, you killed it, bro. It looked great. The blue avatars going around through space, jumping on dragons, flying around through floating rocks. It looks cool, I get it. But it didn't have that emotional impact the Endgame had. People were like leaving the theater heartbroken, crying, screaming. I've never been in such a lively theater. When I saw Avatar, people were like, oh wow, that looks really cool. Guys, Avatar needs to be dethroned. We all need to go together and help out Endgame. We need to assemble and get Endgame to the number one spot. Because more deserving. I might be a little bit biased. I mean, Endgame's my favorite movie of all time. I just wanted to see dethrone Avatar. I don't think Avatar's worthy. Captain America's not wielded Mjolnir to not beat the number one spot. Guys, we all gotta do it. Assemble, go to the theaters, take your kids, take your family, take your brother, sister, parents, grandparents, dogs, whatever you do, buy a ticket, and go help Endgame dethrone Avatar. Quick little rant for you. I know, I'm excited. I want to go see it. I'm gonna go see it. You guys need to go see it. And I don't know if you guys can tell, but I'm a little excited that it has the possibility of re-releasing and has the possibility of dethroning the unworthy Avatar. And guys, one last thing. Hey, Avatar, on your left.
Oh, there are quite a bit of people in my life that do go see movies, that do go see adventure movies, not to the same obsessiveness or degree that, you know, myself or yourself would, but they wanted to go see it. They haven't gotten around to it, right? But they hear everyone else talking about it and it's all good things. So I think with this new buzz that there's going to be a deleted scene and an after credit and everyone else is going out to see this, like you and me, we're going to see that. Like right. if there's an after credit, you and me are chasing that thing like immediately. And like anyone else who, like my wife, she wants to go see it again. She wanted to see it again before this news broke. And so we were talking about going to see it. And now this news broke. We're like, yeah, we're seeing it again. Like for sure. 100%.
Absolutely.
One point that I thought was really interesting when I saw this article and people were like freaking out. Oh, it's cheating or oh, like just let it be. It's like, well, you guys weren't saying that when Black Panther was re-released after it was
that
closed down
true.
For Black History Month.
I forgot about that.
Like, it was re-released for Black History Month. And it's like, what, is it just a good cause because it's for minorities? It is. It's a good cause. Mm-hmm. It's a good movie. It's a darn good movie. It made a buttload of money, but what they didn't have was the billion-dollar breaker. So they re-released it and got the number. It happened. I mean, it's now they're going for $2.788 billion for this one. And it's like everyone's freaking out. It's like, oh, what? They're not allowed to dethrone a movie that cheated just as much or more? I mean, Avengers is still in theaters. If they want to extend it to get that number, they absolutely should. They absolutely should. Why would you right. not do that? If you're a producer, if you're making movies and that's your living, why would you not want to close out a 10-year project by breaking every single box office record that ever happened? Like, you're going to stop when there's one left and you're $44 million away? I don't think so, dude. I don't think so.
No,
like, you're going
not at
that
all.
Goal.
Absolutely. And that's exactly what I would do. But the thing is that what I'm trying to get at is that if it was a movie like, say, Aquaman, fun movie, not a great movie,
right.
But if they were going to leave it out there for 66 weeks, it's just like you are trying too hard. And I wouldn't say it's cheating. Maybe they come out with an extended version of that as well to try and hit that record, which they shouldn't because that movie is already so freaking long to begin with. But if it was like a B movie, then it wouldn't make sense. Maybe you could say, oh, you're whatever. It's not cheating. It's the name of the game. But
right.
It's Avengers Endgame, which we know by the numbers, by the fans, by the legacy that has behind it. We know that this is a movie that, first off, people probably should have all seen this coming.
Today, I would like to talk about Marvel Studios' shameless and deplorable use of Stan Lee and his name in order to drive an agenda. Now, why didn't Avengers Endgame have a tribute to Stan Lee? I wonder. You would think a movie that's such a grand spectacle, that has been a culmination of 10 years of filmmaking, and a big honor to Stan Lee bringing his vision and his characters to life, wouldn't feature a Stan Lee tribute. But it didn't. I think we all waited for it, but it wasn't there. Why does it need to include something that should have been there in the first place? A movie like Captain Marvel featured one, and also had a better Stan Lee cameo than Avengers Endgame. How does that work? But I digress, I'm drifting off topic. The topic of the conversation is Marvel Studios' deplorable and shameless use of Stan Lee's name and a tribute in his name and honor to gimmick people back into the seats to simply drive an agenda so they could pass Avatar number one at the box office, making Avengers Endgame the number one movie in history. But, again, the question is raised, why are we now doing this when this is something that should have been included in the original theatrical cut of Endgame to begin with? I mean, come on, people. This is purely an agenda-driven act, and the fact that they are using Stan Lee's name to do it is just completely shameless, disrespectful, and deplorable, and I cannot support it. I cannot sit here and not speak out about it, because the man deserves more respect than this. It's just a pure, unadulterated gimmick to sell some tickets, to make some money, because they can't stand being number two at the box office.
The thing that makes me think is what else is there? I mean, it was a 3-hour movie. What did they leave out on purpose to have this extended release? And that's kind of what you and me were talking about on the phone. And the crazy thing is I knew that this stuff broke, but ladies and gentlemen who are watching this, you got to give credit to where credit is due to the stuff of legend Daniel. Go and check him out again, by the way. But he called me up. He's like, dude, this is the news. This is what's happening. We need to make this video. He is always on top of it. When it comes to nerd news, nerd culture, all of that stuff, he is on top of it for sure. So be sure to go and check out his channel after this. What we talked about on the phone was what we kind of thought. Well, mainly like our theories of what maybe end credit scenes or deleted scenes could be.
Yeah.
And I wanted to be able to kind of talk about that so that, I mean, maybe people aren't interested in seeing it. But what would you be interested in seeing in an extended cut in theaters?
So with the extended cut, I mean, the reason why the movie was 3 hours was because they had to cut almost 40 minutes, 30 minutes of footage that they actually wanted in the movie, but for obvious reasons couldn't have. So they needed a movie that was approximately 3 hours. So it was so long that they could get everything into it, but short enough that people would still go see the movie. And so like a 3-hour benchmark, it looks clean, it looks nice, it's intimidating, but it's doable. If you have 3.5 hours, it's like people are automatically rounding up. They're like, 4 hours? I'm not going to sit in a theater for 4 hours. That's like a third, fourth of my day, depending on how long you sleep.
People were still freaking out over 3 hours, and they were like freaking out. And I remember thinking, it's like, Lord of the Rings is still longer than all of that together. But you said 40 minutes cut out. Do you think we're going to see 40
approximately.
Minutes? Approximately.
No,
you think we're not going to see that in an extended, you think?
Absolutely not. Here's the exact quote from Kevin Feige. So he says this, he says, we are doing that regarding the re-release and the extendeds. So he says, we are doing that. Feige said of an Endgame re-release with new footage. He continues and says, I don't know if it's been announced and I don't know how much, yeah, we're doing it next weekend. So almost immediately, this is going to take place where they are going to, it's not coming out of theaters and then coming back. It's just going to stay in theaters. They're going to submit to the theaters that are currently holding the film the new reel that includes after the movie's done, there will be the scenes that they said scene that was cut out. It looks like it's going to be at least, it's going to be about one scene approximately is the assumption that was cut from the film. There was talk, and I know this is going to kind of get into that, but it says there's going to be an after credit and a deleted scene. So it'll be the same film all the way through. Once the film is done and then they do the signatures with Robert Downey Jr., Chris Evans, all that beautiful stuff, like the tribute and the sign out, right? After that, there's supposed to be a deleted scene that was removed from the film. I think that that is going to be one of a couple of things. I think that the first thing that I think is most likely is that, you remember how Catherine Langford was on the IMDb?
Yeah, you were mentioning that on the phone, and I thought that was really interesting. Remind me who Catherine Langford is, actress-wise.
If I'm not mistaken, Catherine Langford is the chick from, what's it called? 13 Reasons Why, Love, Simon.
Okay.
She's going to be in a thing called Knives Out. She's in The Misguided. So she's a young actress. I think she's about 23 right now. 5'5". Normal, you know, normal chick, brunette, white, but she has, she was one of the first 20 or so listed people on IMDb. And then once the movie came out, her credit was removed. So she was in the film somehow, but then not credited during the movie. And everyone was confused because a lot of us were fan theorying that she might be like after the time jump, that might've been Hawkeye's daughter. Or it might have been, like, there's a number of people that were like, who could that possibly be? That might be Kate Bishop, you know, the person that takes over for Hawkeye as opposed to being his daughter. But it came out after the movie that she was actually playing Robert Downey Jr.'s daughter's character just in the future. And you're saying, well, she was a little girl in the movie. She wouldn't be that far along after 5 years. Because it was the after 5 years when she showed up. So it's not like there's another time jump that you have to hit in order to grow the little girl. How does that make sense? Well, in Infinity War, when Thanos snapped and dusted everybody, he teleported out and he had this kind of like vision where he saw what we believe to be inside the Soul Stone. He saw Kid Gamora. Now, Gamora was an adult who was now being seen as a kid. And he asks her, what did it cost? She says, what does it cost? He says everything. And then it kind of snaps out and then he's not there anymore. He's in the garden. So it came out was that she was actually, Catherine Langford was playing Morgan Stark in the future. When Tony gets the gauntlet at the end and he does the snap, it's obviously killing him. But the deleted scene that was cut from the film last minute was Catherine Langford, his daughter Morgan, instead of being a kid, it's the opposite. She's in the future. She's almost an adult. She's basically an adult now. And she has a short conversation with Tony after the snap. So he gets that same Soul Stone vision kind of thing.
Now, is this speculation on your part, or is this stuff that you've researched or you've also read and all of that kind of stuff? Because to me, that makes sense. But is that really something that they felt like they needed to add for an extended release for Avengers Endgame? I mean, an end credit scene makes sense. A lot of people were already saying that there was already an end credit scene. I didn't see one in my theater, but some people were saying that there already was one. I mean, what is going to get people in their seats? It's a great theory, but is it a theory at this point, or is this something that you've looked up?
This was actually something that the Russo brothers had mentioned. It was the alternate ending to the movie.
I don't ever believe the Russos. Like, they lie so much. It makes sense. They need to keep everything under wraps for the hugest movie ever. Yeah. But, like, I don't put too much stock into what they say. It makes sense, though. It's a theory that makes sense, and if it's an alternate ending, I mean, that could be pretty interesting. I'm just curious to see if people would actually, like, now that they're hearing this, and now that you've already heard this, is that something that will get you in the theater to watch again?
Absolutely. Like, for me, if it's something, because this was, it wasn't new. Like, honestly, you can mistrust the Russos. You can mistrust Kevin Feige leading into a movie. They have said things to be misdirecting and to try to get people off of the trail of what's going down if they're keeping secrets, which they do. I have no problem with that because I enjoy the mystery. I enjoy the mystique and the fan theories and stuff like that. It's fun for me. And they understand that that's why we have fun with these things, because it's like a giant mystery box. It's like J.J. Abrams' mystery box. You beg the question, but you never surrender the answer. But with them, with the Russos, the answers come out in the movie. So with them saying this, they said it after the movie came out. And that's why I think we can trust it, because they have no reason to lie at that point. So right. After the movie comes out, it's like they're talking about the past. They're talking about this was going to be the ending, but we had to cut it.
Right.
Because it seemed unnecessary because of the ending they already had with Pepper Potts and Peter there. And then, you know, the funeral scene and like all that stuff. So it was moot. It was unnecessary. And they cut it for time because the other stuff felt more relevant and more important than trying to do the opposite of what Thanos did just to mirror that.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, you don't need to mirror that. You know, it's unnecessary. So
I honestly feel like
the literal antithesis of Infinity War.
I honestly feel like it would be something that I would want to see. I walked out of the theater super, super full, super, like, I felt great about everything. Like, I wasn't like, oh, they should have done this or they didn't do that. And I felt great. But hearing all of that, I'm thinking, yeah, that would have been a great send off. Because now thinking about it, as a father, you as a father as well, I'm sure we wanted Tony to see his daughter one last time. That would be pretty cool to happen. I have different theories, though. Because, I mean, I heard this news earlier today, then you called me, then between the time of us getting off the phone and doing this, I've been thinking a lot lately. And what has been going on? I mean, the first thing that comes to everyone's mind, honestly, correct me if I'm wrong about you too, but everyone probably jumped to X-Men. Everyone probably jumped to the Fox characters, the Fox properties. That's where I'm at. But the thing is we don't really know what their plans are. Some people may not know, like, some people make the claims to say that Kevin Feige and all of them don't even know what their plans are with the X-Men and all of that. You and I both feel like that's BS. Of course they know what they're doing with this. I mean, that's Kevin Feige started his career with the X-Men. We talked about this. But the thing is, everyone's probably thinking X-Men. Everyone's probably thinking there's going to be a deleted scene with Wolverine or with Xavier or Cyclops or something. I'm thinking that's more of an end credit kind of deal. I'm thinking that's going to be something we see at the end. I don't know. Like, I'll ask your thoughts there. But I've had a few people talk to me and say, like, well, we haven't seen this, that, and the other. We didn't see what happened to Hawkeye in between the battle and all of that kind of stuff. There's little holes there. I don't really necessarily think that's what's going to get people in their seats. I mean, people go to this extended release. They're going to leave and they're going to tell other people, like, oh, this is what they saw, because other people are going to ask, is it worth my time? Should I really go? It's going to be a scene that I think is hard hitting, the one like you had said. So in my personal opinion, if there's any deleted scene, I think it's either going to be something with Iron Man, because we now know that he has died, or maybe possibly we see something hint towards Fox. Even a deleted scene, we might see them go back in time and meet Hank Pym and all of that in that era, and in walks Wolverine just as like fan service or whatever. You know, that would be kind of cool. I think that would be a cool thing to have happen. But when it comes to the Fox properties, I think it's going to be an end credit scene.
What is up, guys? My name is Ewan Moorfield, and I just want to give my thoughts on the re-release of Avengers Endgame. Now, a lot of people are kind of displeased that it's getting re-released. For me, As long as it gets to that number one spot and takes down Avatar, I'm all for it. There are a few things I'd absolutely love to see that have been requested non-stop by fans, and that's Captain America meeting Red Skull, taking the Soul Stone back to Vormir. I think that would be a phenomenal scene to see, linking back all the way to Captain America the First Avenger. Along with the Hulk versus Thanos rematch, that was something that people really wanted to see, which unfortunately we didn't get in Endgame, but if that is a deleted scene, I'd love to see that. And I'd also like to see maybe some reunions between characters in that final battle, such as maybe Rocket and Groot as a good example. In terms of what I think we'll see, I think it's more likely to be something from that first act, such as maybe an alternative scene of someone other than Hawkeye going back in time for the very first time.
We believe it's going to be both. There's supposed to be an end credit scene at the very, very end. And then right after the movie's done, before the credits kind of roll, there's supposed to be a special deleted scene that was supposed to be in the cut, but was cut for time. So we're going to get both. I'm under the impression, based on the news that has come out, which is that much is it's inferred, but not 100% confirmed.
It never is.
Right, so it's, you know, like we're just waiting for more talk on that, and it hasn't been very long. Like, we're pretty hot on this topic right now, but I think that you're absolutely right. Almost everyone's minds jump to X-Men and Fantastic Four.
Yes,
and it's Fox characters. So if it's going to be, and then there's the rest of everyone else is like, well, what's the next movie coming out? It's Spider-Man Far From Home. They have so much media marketing going on for that already. They're not going for that. If it's something Spider-Man related, to me, that's going to be almost a bummer, maybe a disappointment. It's possible that they might be explaining the time gap with a scene.
That was my next thought, because I thought, like, of course they're going to do a Spider-Man one. But then I thought I'd kind of be disappointed with that. Also, Kevin Feige, I think the people over at Marvel know what they're doing, and they know that that's probably what we're expecting, and they want us. They're not going to give us what we expect. They're going to give us the opposite of that. And unless it's something hugely hard hitting, that I want to see it.
Most people who are like you and me, where we study like the data, we talk, we interact and interface with people that are constantly like doing these interviews. We listen to who's talking, the Russos, Feige, Alan Horn, you know, like those guys. With the rumor that happened not too long ago about Charlie Hunnam being in talks for a new Wolverine movie, right?
Right.
That is something that is not confirmed, but is rumored, and it's rumored from sources that have in the past been credible. Not 100% of the time, but a good amount. You know, like they've shared some things, and it's like, okay, well, if we're looking at it like that, then you gotta take into consideration that it's possible that right after they cut the ground on the deal with Fox, it's like everything's signed, sealed, delivered. They're ready to start thinking and planning, strategizing. Not that they weren't before, but really to start on paper strategizing and coming up with a game plan for the characters that are important to Fox, like X-Men, Fantastic Four, Silver Surfer, Namor, Glax, all those guys, even though Namor is different. But in that situation, it looks like the rumors are that they're trying to get individual characters off the ground.
Mm-hmm.
Immediately. And these things could happen either on Disney Plus, they could happen in the movies. Obviously, they want to milk as much money as they possibly can from the movies. Then they'll drop it on Disney Plus.
Right.
But if that's true, we could very realistically be seeing a tease, not an actor tease. Like, not, we're not going to see Wolverine stroll onto camera, but we might see like a yellow and black suit. You know, like we might see someone talking about what the Weapon X program. You know, we might be hearing about people referring to Captain America as Weapon 1.
Right.
And then that alluding to Weapon X, and then Weapon 13, and then Weapon 20, X-23.
That'd be sick.
You know, all those guys. Because that, they already, I don't know if you saw the cryptic message that Marvel tweeted out like a week ago. I was going to make a video, but I've been slammed lately. So I've been trying to keep up with like a billion things. But they did a huge cryptic message that looks like it's like in code, and it's super, it's like, do not read, do not publicize, blah, blah, blah. But it's tweeted out by Marvel, you know, and it's about like, it goes down this long laundry list of code, and then it gets to a file, what looks like a file, and it reads like everything's all blacked out except for certain words. And it's talking about first Captain America Weapon 1. And he was the first governmental experiment with superhumans and super soldiers, which it's Captain America. He's the first one. And so it goes into him. Then the next one is Wolverine. It's clearly Wolverine, Weapon X. Then after that, it's Weapon 13. And that guy, I'm forgetting what his name was. It's like, Phantom X.
Gotcha.
Phantom X. And so he's like a super thief that's, instead of adamantium, they infuse him with nanites. And so he gets this like nanotechnology infusion instead of an adamantium skeleton, and he becomes this like super crazy good thief. He speaks with a French accent, and he's like if you were to put like Gambit and like Terminator together, or like Terminator Dark Fate Terminator, you know?
There you go. Like, it makes sense to what you're saying. Like everything is kind of still up in the air when it comes to characters, actors, actresses, so on and so forth, with the Fox properties. We get that. Yeah. And I totally think that's what I think we would say. You know how like we saw a lot of like a big teaser that Star Trek did back in the day when the new 2009 movie was coming out, was that we just saw the Enterprise spaceship being under construction, and that was all the trailer was. That's kind of what I think, yeah, is going to happen. Maybe an end credit scene of like, who knows, like the Academy, the X-Men Academy, or maybe the Fantastic, yeah, Four building or something like that. Like, I really think it's going to be something small, but the big thing is that what would that mean for the Fox properties and for the MCU? What are these end credit scenes, these deleted scenes, what could that possibly mean? Do you think that means that they're going to be fast tracking some of these Fox properties? Do you think that it's just going to expand so much more faster rather than later? What would you want to have happen, and what do you think could possibly happen if our theories are right?
Okay, so a lot of questions on that, but I'll do my best. So I think with this, what it means if we get something like an X-Men tease or a Fantastic Four tease, I do not believe we're going to see any actors representing those characters, right, in an after credit. I don't believe that. It's far too soon. They haven't officially cast anybody, or they haven't made any announcements towards that, but there has been a massive movement back towards the Fox characters in recent days. A lot of the mobile games have started to add and include Fox characters. Silver Surfer has been a huge push. I think Marvel's Instagram or their Twitter, actually their banner was a Silver Surfer comic, and they're pushing back into the Fox owned characters like they haven't done in years.
Right.
And the only time where they include those characters is in combination with Avengers or characters that are property of theirs that they can benefit off of. That was part of their huge like leveraging point against Fox for years. They took them out of Marvel versus Capcom Infinite. They took them out of Marvel versus Capcom 3, didn't even have them. That was the first time when Wolverine or the X-Men or one character from the Fantastic Four wasn't in a Marvel versus Capcom game. Right. Like, they actually always had like Storm or they had like Magneto, or they had, you know, Cyclops, Wolverine, they had mutants. They always had those. And it's always been one of the biggest pushes. Now, X-Men comics have always done well, so they didn't pull X-Men comics from the list of publishing things, but they canned Fantastic Four. And you saw a huge push in Inhumans because they were trying to replace the fan base,
right,
of,
yeah,
X-Men to put a chokehold on Fox to release the rights. Now we have the rights. So now you're seeing all these mobile games. It's like, now you can get Wolverine. We've got Deadpool back in the mix. We've got, you know, like, you can play as Cyclops. You can play as Magneto. Play as all your favorite mutants. And then, like, you get the Fantastic Four back in there. Galactus is an enemy. And now even for Marvel Ultimate Alliance, which is coming out for Nintendo Switch, which is literally the reason I bought a Nintendo Switch, that's coming out, I think, in like 2 months, if I'm not mistaken. I'm so excited. Best game franchise of all time. But they're huge push now. The last two trailers and then the last teaser have been 100% about mutants in the game. And like, they're trying to let people know mutants are back, and if you want to play as mutants, you come here.
What does it mean, the X-Men coming into the MCU, or at least having an extended cut, or sorry, a deleted scene in the extended cut? release. What does it mean? Could it possibly mean that they're going to be fast-tracking it and making it sooner rather than later? I don't know. I don't know if I would want that, because I want them to take care of the characters slowly. Because, like, it's a, like, even though they're characters we know, they're still characters that we need to warm up to. And that's what they did with Spider-Man. I mean, they didn't give us an origin for Tom Holland's Spider-Man, because they know that we know all of that kind of stuff. But they, right, they made us warm up to those characters. Maybe that's what they do here. But mainly, any of these... I honestly feel like these deleted scenes, these end credit scenes, are going to be something that's going to make us excited for what's to come. Like, the, right, the theory with Tony Stark's daughter... is a sensible one. It is one that would make me go into the theater, but it isn't something that would get me hyped for what's to come in the future. And I'm going to be honest with you, after Avengers Endgame, there was a little bit of fatigue. Even with me, I'm just like, it's done. It's a conclusion. It wrapped up really nicely. I didn't need anything else. I was even worried that Avengers Endgame was going to end in a set, like, with a cliffhanger. It was like, tune in for Spider-Man Far From Home, you know? Even though it kind of is, people can argue that, it still wrapped everything up really nicely. That's why I think the movie is so great. But, like, I think that they're going to give us something that will make us want to see more. That's why they won't show us a Spider-Man one. Possibly they will, but it will give us something to for us to look forward to. And I think the X-Men is hopefully, or the Fantastic Four, anything Fox related, I think that's it. That would be a dead ring. That would get me into the theater multiple times and look forward to seeing more.
I agree. And, you know, like, I think that you're right about the conclusion feeling, like, it left you completely, like, comfortable, comforted. Like, you're like, the whole journey has basically wrapped. If they had stopped making Marvel movies after that point, it would be sad, but it would make sense, because they actually left you feeling whole at the end of that, even though Tony dies. And, like, there's consequences that happen there that are very, you know, powerful and impactful. But you still feel complete after watching that movie. Now, same thing. After that, I was kind of like, I almost felt like no urgency to watch another film. So, like, everything after that is kind of like, it's almost unnecessary. And I don't mean that like I don't want them. I desperately want more movies.
Right, right.
But when you walk out of that movie, you're almost like, if I stop now, I can keep this feeling, you know? And if you keep going, now you're hooked again. And it's like, here we go. You know, it's starting anew almost. Even though Far From Home is technically the end of that chapter. So Far From Home is still part of that 10-year journey. We got to check that out and see what happens there. Tom Holland's kind of a goon. He kind of spoiled the fact that there is another movie after that for him. And we don't know if it's like another Avenger film, another combination, team up or something, but he called it a trilogy, and I don't think he was talking about Civil War. So he said he was on contract for a Spider-Man trilogy. So that, to me, I think we're going to be looking at more happening there. I'm excited. I like him. I want him in the MCU. I think that's a good thing. But what it means for the MCU, when you get something like a tease, an after credit, that is not something that is for an immediate, like a Spider-Man Far From Home, but like X-Men, there's so many characters. We want them to do justice on them. It makes sense to want them to just take their time. But if we're being honest, there's a lot of characters we already know the background to. We already know their story. Like, you could outright make a Magneto movie immediately. You could make a Brotherhood movie where Magneto's gathering the Brotherhood, challenging, he's fighting the X-Men, where the X-Men kind of pose themselves as the bad guys, but it's the bad guys to his cause. You know, they're the good guys, but you're following them the opposite. It's like Infinity War. Infinity War had Thanos get the hero's journey. Thanos had his backstory explained. He had his motivations clear. You understood him. You almost sympathize with the guy, even though he's absolutely off his rocker. And like with the X-Men, you could play it the opposite. You could have a Brotherhood movie and an X-Men movie, them go at it, and then have a separate Wolverine movie where he's not in the X-Men. He's completely separate. Wolverine could either be standalone. You could start him out in a Weapon X program thing. You could start him out in Alpha Flight. You could start him out just in a solo journey. It doesn't matter where you start him because he's got stories for days. And we all know his story. He's like Batman at this point. Everyone knows Wolverine. Everyone understands his character. Arguably one of the most recognizable characters of all time, probably next to Batman and Spider-Man.
Absolutely.
You could kick him off. You could throw Storm into Black Panther 2. You could throw Namor into Black Panther 2. Tell his origin and kick him off into the MCU right away.
I want that so bad. That would be so
like,
cool.
Like, there's tons of application for these things.
Yes.
Oh, dude, for sure, man.
That's the greatest thing about this franchise, about this MCU experience, is that there's so much potential. And just like you said, keeping the feelings after Endgame, yeah, that's a huge fear. Like, that, there's a lot of things that could go wrong. But I really think that, I mean, they've done this franchise so well lately. They've only had a couple flops, and considering those flops made a buku bucks, I think.
By definition, makes them not a flop. It just means they weren't awesome.
Exactly, because they're still killing it in comparison to anything else that comes out into theaters. So in conclusion, really, just want to, first off, just say that I'm super excited for this. I'm so pumped to not only see an extended cut, but to go and see the movie again. I just want to know what you are thinking. So comment down below. Tell us, are you going to be seeing the extended cut when it comes out? Have you seen enough? Is the MCU dead? It probably isn't, but if you think so, comment down below. I'd love to hear it, because that's what we do here. We just talk about nerdy things, and I love hearing about different perspectives. And me and Daniel have a lot of different perspectives on things when it comes to the nerd culture, and that's why him and I get along. It doesn't sound like we should, but we do, because we respect each other's opinions and we go at it all the time here. Go check out his channel. Thanks so much, dude. Seriously, appreciate you calling, because he just called and he's just like, we got to do this. Let's do it now. And then it was just a matter of me updating my software just to do this. So I'm so glad that you called, dude. You're always welcome here.
Hey, thanks, man. I really appreciate it. And last words is just, I did a poll on my Instagram where I basically just asked, is it good or bad that Avengers is going to extend their theatrical run for, you know, in order to beat the Avatar box office, and by adding that scene and an end credit scene. And I've got 13 yeses and only one no.
There you have it. There you have it, folks. The people of Instagram don't lie.
Let us know what you guys think down below.
Absolutely. Go check out the Stuff of Legend, both Instagram and YouTube. He's killing it over there. He's got a hat. He's got to get merch, because I need to wear one of those. I want one of them. This is me calling him out right now. So thank you guys so much for tuning in here at Beside the Point here on Nerdy Blurb TV, where we like to keep it nerdy all the time. But until next time, seriously, we'll see you again.
Music makers, and we are the dreamers of dreams.
Thank you guys so much for tuning in here today at Nerdy Blurb TV and checking out this video. Consider subscribing if you're into this kind of stuff, because we like to keep it nerdy here and interact with cool individuals such as yourself. Have a great day.